for the American team. And after that, probably a career in professional hockey.
What about hockey?
Back to the hockey game. Early in the third and final period, the Soviet Union still led the United States by a score of 3-2. Let's pick it up again now with Al Michaels.
The Soviets in the American end. Harlamov couldn't get a stick on the shot in from the point. The Americans now in control as O'Callaghan shoots it into the Soviet end. 16-15, the player in the third period. The teams were tied 2-2 after the first. The Soviets leading 3-2. Al Michaels and former Montreal goaltender Ken Dryden at the Olympic Center. The Americans coming into this medal round unbeaten. The Soviets also unbeaten. They won all five of their games and scored 51 goals in the process. Strobel ahead to Wells. In on the left side comes Rakota. And then it's taken away in front of the Soviet net by Starikov, clearing it along the board. The Soviets with Petrov, number 16. Petrov. Mikhailov trying to center it. Rakota back the other way. Rakota, the center ice, in over the blue line to Johnson. His shot deflected in front. And Vasiliev, number 6 for the Soviets. 15-20 remaining in the game. Mikhailov losing it to Silk. Johnson ahead to McClanahan. He's ridden out of the play by Slukov. Vasiliev pounded by Johnson. Taken away by McClanahan. But back it comes to center ice. And McClanahan losing it at center ice. The Soviets waiting to get onside. Makarov skating in. Puts the defense and then can't get the shot away. A break for the U.S.
U.S. team again, very careless on defense. They've got to pick up Makarov. He's a very dangerous offensive player.
14-40 now remaining in the third period. This is Makarov, number 24. Makarov again tries to split the defense, and Craig falls on it for a whistle.
The U.S. team in the second period, they had two shots on goal. They had two other good chances, shots that or plays that didn't result in shots on goal, but they've just got to do a whole lot more. Here's Makarov beating Ramsey. Now Morrow, and fortunately the puck seems to roll off his stick a little bit, although Craig was well positioned and would have forced him into a good shot.
The U.S. winless against the Soviets since 1960, since that day at Squaw Valley. It's been 20 years since an American team has beaten the Soviets. The Soviets, of course, gold medal winners every Olympics since 1960. They've entered six tournaments in all and won five of them. Offside the call here with 14-19 now remaining in the game.
The Soviets have a very unusual line out there for them at the moment. They have Krutov, number 9, Lebedev, 11, and Maltsev, 10, all of whom play on different teams in the Soviet Union, on Army, on Wings, and on Dynamo. And the Soviets are known for putting lines together and keeping them together, and yet this line has been very successful.
Lebedev shooting it in as Craig leaves it back of the net for Baker. Do you think Tikhanov is doing that to confuse the Americans, Ken?
No, I don't think so. I think what it is that there really are three outstanding individual hockey players. They don't really play that much as a line, but they're very effective individually, much like the French Connection was in Buffalo with Perrault, Martin, and Robert. Again, not working that well together, but individually being so good that they were an effective unit.
Kasatinov shooting it into the American end. Craig stopping it back of the net. Davey Christian with the puck now. Trying to come out with 13:30 remaining in the game. The Soviets still on top, 3-2. Up ahead to Pavlik. Pavlik can't find a Ruzioni. Kasatinov back to clear it along the near boards to Fedosov, number 2. Fedosov up ahead to Krutov. Krutov shoots it in. This is Broughton for the U.S. Neal, number 9. And we've got a penalty coming up on the Soviets. Referee Carl Gustav Kaisler of Finland calling a penalty on the Soviets here for elbowing. And so the Americans with a power play opportunity, 13-13 to go in the game, 3-2 Soviets.
Just when you think life is all it can be, surprise! You see the light and suddenly everything seems so bright.
It's the light, GE, it's the light.
go, son. John and your mother are waiting.
I'll catch up, Dad. This is important.
So is this dinner.
Partner.
Partner.
Have you ever heard it, son?
Now you should know about Inglenook, America's superior wine. For those moments in life that are just a little special, remember Inglenook when the toast is from your heart.
To my new partner, who I love like a son.
Vladimir Khrushchev going off for high-sticking here as we look at the replay.
Well, here's Broughton. He's carrying the puck. Khrushchev did slash him. However, I think that it was a rather questionable call, especially at this time of the game with a 3-2 score in a game of this great importance. I think normally that kind of play would have been waved off. However, it does give the U.S. team the opportunity really that they're looking for. They haven't been able to go on the offense for quite some time now, and this is the chance.
Exactly. Oftentimes it's overlooked, but the Americans with a power play opportunity, only their second of the game. Kristoff in over the blue line, taken out of the play by Billy Letanov, and the Soviets clear it. 13 minutes exactly now left in the third period. The Soviet Union on top, 3-2. Ramsey shooting it into the Soviet end. Comes out to the point now. Christian keeping it in with his skate. Christian gets the return pass. Christian over to Broughton, has to play it off the board. Neal comes back out to Ramsey. Long slap shot. The save by Muschietta. Ruzioni, his rebound shot was wide, and Christian is back to get it. It comes out to the point, but nobody is there. And so the puck comes back out over the blue line. The Americans have to set up again. Broughton, number 9. Ruzioni now picks it up, number 21, the team captain out of Boston University. 25 years old, Kristoff. Controlling in the corner now. Vilya Letanov is right there, and he's able to clear. Back come the Soviets. Golikov now. Golikov shot. Ramsey got a piece of it to deflect it wide. Ruzioni moves it up ahead to Broughton. 12 minutes to play, 46 seconds left in the penalty. Broughton skating in, but not finding any help. Broughton now, back out to the point to Baker. Baker skates in. Baker trying to get it to Broughton. Neal couldn't get his stick on it. Soviets clear again.
The U.S. isn't disciplined enough on their power play so far. Their positioning is really all over the offensive zone.
Christian losing it. Petrov able to clear again, and only 22 seconds now remaining in the penalty to Khrushchev. So Mushkin tested only once thus far. The Americans with perhaps their final rush on this power play opportunity. 13 seconds left in the penalty. Weak shot for Davis, followed by Johnson. They score!
Well, a goal that absolutely came out of nowhere. The U.S. team did not seem to be threatening. The puck went to Starikov, the Soviet defenseman, who should have had very good control of it, but he lost it. There's Stilt. Now watch the puck go to Starikov. He's in great shape with it, but he loses it right under Johnson's stick and in the net. There we see it again. Stilt upended, but getting the puck to Starikov, the rebound to Johnson and in.
So the Americans, just as the penalty had expired, to Khrushchev score to tie the game. And finally, the building has come to life. 3-3. The United States and the Soviet Union with 11:21 remaining in the third period. Kharlamov, number 17, losing it tomorrow now. Kenny, number 3 with it. The Americans, losers 10-3, 13 days ago. The game now tied. This is Kharlamov on the near side, number 17, passing up ahead to Petrov. Mikhailov skates in on the right side, along with Ramsey. And a whistle as they ice the puck. Face-off coming up in the Soviet zone. 10:58 remaining, the U.S. 3 and the Soviets 3.
Now, Goodyear Technology brings you a new steel-belted radio for the 80s. Today, you need a tire that gives you fuel economy and all-season performance, wet, dry traction, and long tread life, hydroplaning resistance, and dry road stability. New Arriva. Even its footprint tells you it's different. Only from Goodyear.
Goodyear Arriva. Goodyear. Hot heat, dry heat, heat that hurts your hair. You've got hair fever. You need Flex Conditioner. Revlon's unique balsam and protein formula fights dry, heat-wilted hair with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 working conditioners. Leaves hair gloriously healthy-looking, flexible, full of body to hold up under heat. Got hair fever? You need Flex Balsam and Protein Conditioner from Revlon. Beautiful.
We have a man who really uses his head.
That's incredible.
This is News Brief, brought to you by Southwestern Bell.
Good evening, I'm Rick Hall. The Iranian and Arab students that were being held in the county jail have been released, but the charges against them have not been dropped. A phone installer remains in critical condition tonight at Brackenridge Hospital after receiving a severe electrical shock. Austin police sting operation resulted in the arrest of 34 persons involved in a large theft operation. And former UN Ambassador Andrew Young speaks in Austin tonight. Now this.
From now till 11 p.m., save on all long-distance calls. 35% on out-of-state calls. What else is so nice for the price?
More news at 10. Please join it.
You know, breakfast is a popular meal with my family. And sometimes, as a change of pace, they like French toast or cinnamon toast. They just love toast. And they really like butter crust. It's nutritious, and I can always count on that. Really, I wouldn't buy anything but butter crust. You know, when you get right down to freshness and flavor, you just can't beat butter crust. I trust butter crust.
Cary Grant in To Catch a Thief at 11 on 24.
Mark Wells on the face-off against Petrov in the Soviet end. Fedosov, number two, back of the net. Clear that along the near side, and back it comes. Morrow will chase it down with Ramsey, and we'll have an icing call here. So again, the face-off in the Soviet end with 10:46 remaining.
Well, here's where the game becomes a little bit painful, especially for the U.S. team. They know they're playing against a Soviet team that's very good and very explosive, and they're trying to get to a point where they can set the proper course of the game for them. They want the enthusiasm, but they also want the control, and they've got to find the proper balance.
Baker into the corner. Ilyuletinov trying to clear it along the near side. Now it comes to Balderas. He leaves it for Zlukov. Zlukov, number 22, the pass to Makarov. Craig makes the save. The Americans trying to clear the end now. Harrington passing up to center ice. The Soviets take control there. Pervukin with Balderas skating in on the right wing. Balderas back of the net. Tries to get it out in front. Loose puck out in front. And Davey Christian able to get his stick on it to clear it away. Snyder, Buzz, long slap shot, saved by Mushkin.
The U.S. team is depending a little bit too much now on Jim Craig. He's making too many good saves.
Arruzioni! Yes! Mike Arruzioni! Remaining, there's Viktor Tikhonov, the Soviet head coach. There's the man of the moment right now for the first time in this tournament. As we take a look at the replay again, we saw a smile on the face of Herb Brooks.
There we see the replay again, the shot underneath between Mushkin's arm and his body.
4-3, the United States on top with Ramsey. Tomorrow. Up ahead to Starikov. The shot wide into the corner. Lebedev now out in front to Krutov, and it looked like it hit the post.
It did. Maltsev was wide open. There he's again.
Maltsev can't get it in from the left side. The Soviets putting the pressure on. Maltsev coming back out in front. But the Americans, I think, able to clear the zone. They do. We've got a whistle. It's hardly audible here with a crowd going crazy, but a whistle for offside.
The U.S. very fortunate there. The problem that they've had in other games are open men in front of the net. There's Moltsev chipping that shot high up off the post. Then he gets another chance on at the other side. The U.S. team has got to tighten up in front of their net.
So the United States on top, 4-3. The U.S. coming into this middle round, remember, with 1 point. The Soviets had 2 points. So the U.S. with a victory would have 3 points to the Soviets, two. And the U.S.'s fate would be in its own hands as they take on Finland on Sunday. Fedosov. Pekosakhanov gets the return pass now. Up ahead to Alexander Golikov. He has it taken away by Christian. But Makarov. Makarov skating into the corner. Makarov. Back of the net. Kasatanov on the other side. Golikov kept in from the point, but the shot was wide. And back out it comes to center ice. Fedosov, number two, to Makarov. Golikov can't handle the pass, and Johnson has it for the U.S., Mark clearing it in to the Soviet end. David Christian. Back in his own zone now. Harrington circling. 8.5 minutes to play. The Americans trailing. 3-2 coming into this period. Now leading. 4-3. McClanahan. His shot goes wide. Golikov leaving it for his brother. Golikov skating in. Golikov's backhander. The save by Craig. Snyder scrapping for it in the corner. And we've got a whistle as they tie it up with 8:09 to play in the third period. The United States, 4. And the Soviet Union, 3.
Just got it. A Chevrolet Monte Carlo with a turbocharged V6. I looked at a Datsun A10 and a VW Scirocco. But you know, I got lots more room, darn good mileage, and on top of that, I also got turbocharging. More room, good mileage, turbocharged performance. No foreign car can give you that combination at a Chevrolet price. Monte Carlo's got it.
Now we've got it.
Yeah, Chevy's got it. Just come get it.
Gold medal winner Shirley Babichon.
In the pool or out, performance and comfort just plain go together. That's why my towels are 100% cotton. High performance Martex Luxor towels. Super absorbent, super soft, super comfortable. Because they're cotton. Natural 100% cotton. Comfort and performance, they just plain go together.
Comfortable, washable, durable, fashionable. Look for the seal of cotton. Cotton performs.
Monday at 8, 7 Central and Mountain, a 3-hour blockbuster. Elvis.
Oh, my.
He was the superstar that every woman wanted. Elvis. This time, there's no reason to miss it.
Monday.
Was it me? Such is
6:47 to play in the game. The Americans on top 4-3 coming into this middle round. The Soviets came in with 2 points because they beat Finland. The U.S. and Sweden came in with a point each because they tied. Finland, no points because they lost to the Soviets. You pick up 2 points for a win, one for a tie. The Americans right now on the verge of picking up a couple. As Fedosov, slap shot is blocked in front by Morrow.
It's the kind of play that you've got to make from here to the end. Is anybody, when there's a dangerous chance to fall in front of those shots?
Golikov's shot goes wide. Kasatanov keeps it in near the point. Kasatanov slap shot, knocked down in front, gloved by Craig, and a whistle with 6:26 to play in the third period. Remember, on Sunday, the other games in the medal round, it'll be the U.S. against Finland. It'll be the Soviet Union taking on Sweden.
Here's the big play by Ken Morrow, diving in front of that shot from Fedosov. The U.S. team has been getting into the kind of pattern that they want, playing the game all over the ice surface, not just in their own end. But they've got to keep continually clear their zone better.
Craig has 33 saves tonight. The two Soviet goaltenders, remember, Tretiak played the first period, Mushkin the second and third. They have only 12 saves. The Soviets have outshot the Americans by close to a 3-1 ratio, and yet it's the U.S. on top as you look at the clock. 6:26 remaining in the game. 4-3 the United States.
Here again, the U.S. team is trying to slow the pace of the game down to make sure that they're in control. Herb Brooks bringing Mark Johnson over to the bench for more instructions, the referee having to bring him back to the faceoff, but all to provide a little bit of time and a little bit of rest and a little bit of composure.
McClanahan on the faceoff against Lukov. This is Ramsey. on his own. The Soviets trying to get it back in. Morrow takes control of the puck now for the U.S. Kenny, number three, passing it into the Soviet end. Kasatinov back there, along with Johnson. Johnson trying to clear it along the boards to Silk's side. But the Soviets are able to get it back to center ice. Golikov, down to Makarov. Makarov, skating into the corner, sent it out in front, but Golikov couldn't get his stick on it. Kasatinov now. Fedosov, out in front. Makarov again, taken out of the play. Good play by Ramsey. But the Soviets able to keep it in, and we've got a whistle as Makarov takes control.
Mike Ramsey, who's been struggling with his defensive play, particularly in front of his own net, made two very good plays in front, hooking Golikov's stick first and then clearing the puck away on the second chance.
Here's Herb Brooks. The last call, the Soviets were protesting that call for offside. But the play blown dead. The referee tonight from Finland, the two linesmen from Canada and Holland. 5:46 remaining in the game. The United States on top. 4-3. Billy Letinov shoots it in. It's deflected high. Strobel fighting for it. Back it comes to center ice. So the Soviets will have to set up again. 5.5 minutes to play. Petrov, number 16. Long slap shot. And Craig able to sweep it aside. And the puck clears the glass and goes into the seats. So Jim Craig tested time and time again tonight with 5:21 remaining in the game.
That last play, Petrov took the shot from outside the blue line. You see him here, but look at the U.S. team. They've got four players lined up on the blue line, and Petrov, seeing that, realized that all he could really do was take the shot.
Jim Craig. And at Boston University, he's played every minute of every game thus far in the tournament. The American, a 10-3 loser to the Soviets less than 2 weeks ago in Madison Square Garden. Leading right now 4-3. But remember, Canada also led the Soviets at the end of the second period, and Finland led with only 5 minutes to play in the game the other night. Ilya Letinov over to Pervukin. Pervukin shooting it into the American end. Craig leaving it there for Baker. Broughton trying to get it out, but the Soviets keeping it in. And Strobel. Now Kristoff clearing it into the Soviet zone. And this will be icing here. So the faceoff in front of Jim Craig now with 4:55 remaining in the third period. The United States leading the Soviet Union 4-3.
Typing will never be the same again. Introducing the new IBM Electronic 75 typewriter. It really works for you. Automatically it underlines and centers. Its memory stores 7,500 characters. Want to change a sentence right in the middle? You type the change. The new IBM Electronic 75 typewriter. And if you make a mistake, this typewriter erases it.
I don't know how I'm going to break the news to Charlie Wilson. He needs a whole new engine. $652 just for parts. Look, this is a Fram oil filter, about $6. If you look after your car right, including changing your oil and putting in a new Fram oil filter when you're supposed to, you may never have to face this kind of problem. But the choice is yours. You can pay me now or pay me later.
3:53 remaining in the game. Pavlich on the faceoff in the Soviet end against Vladimir Golikov. Fedosov up to Makarov, number 24. Makarov skating into the American end. Backhander tried to get it over to Golikov. Went through the crease as they fight for it along the near side. Now cleared over to the other side as Ramsey gets it out over the blue line. And Kasatinov is back to get it for the Soviets. Up ahead to Golikov. Golikov losing it there. Harrington in control for the U.S. Harrington, number 28. Harrington skating in. His shot. The save by Mushkin, who juggled the puck, then held on long enough for the whistle. 3:23 to play.
One of the really difficult things about playing against the Soviets and also even watching the game with the Soviets is they never allow you the chance of feeling good. When you're ahead by two goals, by one goal, you'd love to have the luxury of feeling comfortable and feeling good, and yet they can strike so fast that all of a sudden they just steal that feeling away.
Johnson on the faceoff. Johnson, McClanahan, and Silk forming the line on the ice right now for the Americans. The Soviets controlling after the faceoff, but Harlamov loses it at center ice to McClanahan. Harlemov. Christian gets his stick on it. Here back outside the blue line. Petrov and Silk scrapping along with Johnson and Kervukin. Now Mikhailov, the captain. Kervukin. Mikhailov leaving it to Petrov. Petrov skating it over the blue line. Harlemov. Back of the net. The Americans take possession. Baker can't clear. Kervukin keeps it in. And Davey Christian with a puck. 2:43 to play. McClanahan can't control. Mikhailov tried to center. That could have been costly, but it's taken away by Baker. Good play by Bill as Baker skates in with McClanahan and loses the puck, and we've got offside.
David Christian has played extremely well in this game. It's a tough thing for him. He's been a forward all year and really through his entire career, and he's been asked to go back on defense. And that's a very difficult thing to do. In earlier games, he was playing reasonably well, but he was having a hard time with his positioning. He just hasn't developed the defensive instincts. But tonight, he's in position almost all the time and playing extremely well.
Goals by Mark Johnson and Mike Ruzzioli here in the third period. The United States coming from behind to lead 4-3. 2:25, 2:24, 2:23 remaining. Starikov, number 12. Pounded by Strobel. Wells chasing it down in the corner. Mark tries to get it over to Ramsey. Ramsey comes back the other way tomorrow now. 2:09 to play in the game. Strobel up ahead to center ice. The Soviets take possession again. Get it back into the American end. But Morrow is back there for the touch and the icing call for the faceoff in the Soviet end with 1:59 to play in the game.
Ken Morrow was properly going back slowly, knowing it was ice and trying to milk the clock as much as possible, but also remembering the other night when he did the same thing, but let it go too long. The referee blew the whistle and called the faceoff in the American zone.
Honestly, Ken, a couple of months ago, would you have believed this would be possible?
No, absolutely not. But the only thing with this U.S. team is, we've repeated it a number of times, is that they're a very young and a very talented team. And when you are that kind of team, you just have no idea where it's all going to end up.
A minute 58, a minute 57 left in the game. The Soviets losing it. At center ice, it's Christian. To Baker, Phil, number 6. Shooting it into the corner. The Soviets get it back to center zone, but the Americans retain control. Baker, number 6. Baker, shooting it into the Soviet end again. 1:38 remaining in the game.
Soviets are circling their forwards up near center now. Both Makarov and Golikov. They're looking for that long breakaway pass, but it makes it harder in their own zone.
And another icing call right here. 4-3, the United States. Herb Brooks, I think, said it before the tournament even started. He said to win a bronze medal in Lake Placid would be the equivalent or even more winning the gold in Squaw Valley. The Americans, obviously, the better team than they had in 60, but the Soviets are so much better than they were 20 years ago.
I think the biggest difference is the fact that in 1960, most of the teams in the world were unknown one to each other, and you had no idea what to expect. In this particular case, 20 years later, all of these teams know each other pretty well, and when you can be that much of an underdog and make the kind of performance or give the kind of performance that the U.S. team has had, that's very remarkable.
All right, Pervukin over to Petrov, number 16. Petrov with a weak shot in on Craig. Easy save. Ramsey has it in the corner. A minute 15 to play. Back it comes. Can they clear the blue line? They do, and then it comes back in again, and offside is the call.
The Soviets are going to be put in a very unusual position at this moment of having to pull their goalie. The Soviet team has rarely been in the position of being down a goal this late in the game, and I wonder whether they've had much practice of getting Mushkin or Tretiak off the ice.
Remember, the Soviets have a lot of the same players on the team that came over here and beat the New York Rangers and the New York Islanders and Quebec at the end of 1979. A minute 6 remaining in the game. Harlemov losing it to Silk. Now Petrov controls. Back to Harlemov. Getting in on the left side. Into the American end. 55 seconds. But Mikhailov has the puck. Mikhailov sweeping in. Out in front. Backhander goes wide. I think Craig might have got just a piece of it. Mikhailov back out to Vilya Ledyanov. 43 seconds remaining. Morrow checked into the boards. It comes back to center ice. 38, 37 seconds left in the game. Petrov with it. The Americans on top 4-3. Long shot. McCraig able to get a piece of it to sweep it away. 28 seconds. The crowd going insane. Karlamov shooting it into the American end again. Morrow is back there. Now Johnson, 19 seconds. Johnson over to Ramsey. Ilya Letunov gets checked by Ramsey. McClanahan is there. The puck is still loose. 11 seconds. You've got 10 seconds. The countdown going on right now. Morrow up to Schultz. 5 seconds left in the game. Do you believe in miracles? Yes!
Unbelievable.
Assistant coach. Unknown, totally anonymous, a week and a half ago. Look at Herb Brooks.
No notes tonight.
Oh, oh my. Tim Craig, they're still undefeated. They've got 3 points now. They've got their fate in their own hands. They'll take on Finland Sunday. The USA, USA champ. Just incredible. 11 o'clock. Sunday morning, Eastern Time, the U.S. against Finland. There's O'Callaghan. So the United States has done it, defeating the Soviet Union, the most improbable circumstance you could ever have imagined before these Olympics started. The final score, the USA 4, the Soviet Union 3.
You think I feel like an objective reporter right now? You don't know me very well, and I think after all these years, you know me pretty well. What an achievement. That may be the greatest upset in sports history. For comparison, we'll try to imagine that American football was played in the Summer Olympic Games, and then imagine that a team, an all-star team of Canadian college boys, beat the Pittsburgh Steelers. It's that big an upset. Bob Vietti tells us he was in a restaurant called Jimmy's across from our hotel when the result was announced there, and he said all the people in the place spontaneously stood up and sang our national anthem. I personally can't remember anything like that happening since World War II. It's just such a great night. It's a night of national achievement and pride, but more specifically, I think pride in the spirit and the determination and the faith of the young people of this country. They are just sensational. The hockey team and Phil Mayer, what a day. In a minute, you're going to see Jim Lampley talking to Jim Craig, the goalie, and to Mike Ruzzioni, the captain and the man who scored the winning goal as the United States defeated the Soviet Union.
Literally thousands of Olympic fans who have not scurried off to the bus lots tonight, but rather have stayed in Lake Placid to celebrate the dramatic American hockey victory over the Soviet Union. And with me now, two of the great heroes of that victory, Jim Craig, the goalie, Mike Ruzzioni, who scored the winning goal, their parents, Mr. and Mrs. Ruzzioni, and Jim Craig's father. Jim, as much emotion as I think I've ever seen at one sporting event, I wonder if you could feel it down on the ice.
We could feel it throughout the stands, throughout the whole game, and especially in the last 10 minutes of the game.
Do you think nationalistic feeling had a great deal to do with it? The chant, USA, USA?
I think that had a great deal to do with it, and there was a lot of hockey fans there tonight, too.
A
a lot of hockey fans who saw some great hockey. Mike, it seemed to me that one potential turning point in the game was in the second period when the Soviets stormed the net. Jim Craig went down. You spent some time with an official. Seemed to fire your team up.
Well, I think a little. They had sort of taken it to us for a while. And, you know, during a game, you like to try to get any break that you can. They had been peppering Jimmy, putting a lot of shots on him. And just to maybe slow the pace down a little, let the Soviets come back to Earth and get us guys back regrouped again.
Can you reconstruct in your mind what happened on the winning goal?
Well, what had happened was Buzzy Schneider had come off the ice early, and it was my shift up next. I'd come off the boards. When I got to about the red line, I saw John Harrington forecheck their defenseman, and he more or less poked the puck back to Mark Pavlich. Pav tipped it up just inside the blue line. I came in and picked it up, and I skated in and used the defenseman as a screen a little and shot the puck, and next thing I know, it slipped under his pad and was in the net.
And your team was ahead. I wonder if you've ever had a feeling quite like that in your life.
No, I never have. It was a big win for us, and it was a big thing for me and my family and my town and parents. It's just a great game.
Congratulations, Mike. Jim, any problem getting back up for the Finland game?
I don't think we can. We got a great chance for a gold medal. We've worked too hard to get, you know, be here, and I think we'll all be emotionally ready for that game, and hopefully we'll be able to go back to our hometowns with a gold medal.
Well, you certainly have something to celebrate tonight. Congratulations on one of the great moments in American Olympic history, I think. Jim?
You heard it and saw it. They're singing God Bless America in the streets of the little village of Lake Placid tonight, and it's begun to snow. Tomorrow, I had to write it all down. Eric Heiden goes for his fifth gold medal, unprecedented. Women's figure skating live tomorrow night. Linda Fratiani goes for her gold. Women's slalom is tomorrow. So many things. The first two runs of the four-man bobsled. 90-meter ski jump, one of the most spectacular events. 12:30 to 3:30, 8 to 11, and a half an hour from now, our coverage continues. I'm Jim McKay.
The 13th Winter Olympic Games have been brought to you by Inglenook, America's superior wine since 1879. Remember Inglenook when the toast is...
I mentioned that Bobby Elliott walked into a little restaurant on Main Street here in Lake Placid. Well, I was with Bob along with Don Meredith. Bob and I had just come down from the mountain. We really didn't know quite what was going on, and we went to get just a quick bite to eat, and we heard this chanting and cheering, and it was 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and the whole building started to shake, and just as we walked into the restaurant, and that was the end of the hockey game, and you never saw anything like it in your life. They were watching it on Canadian television. All these Americans started to cheer and chant, and then they broke into the Star Spangled Banner, and I'll tell you, it really got me. I've never really felt anything quite like that. I was not only proud of these young kids who have done so well, I was really proud of the Americans here in Lake Placid that really have supported them like nothing I've ever seen. And you know, we've promised you original programming in this late night spot, but not highlights of events you've already seen, but you really couldn't call the final seconds of tonight's hockey match a highlight. You might call it a piece of sports history. Our commentators, Al Michaels and Ken Dryden.
19 seconds. Johnson over to Ramsey. Vilyuletinov gets checked by Ramsey. McClanahan is there. The puck is still loose. 11 seconds. You've got 10 seconds. The countdown going on right now. Morrow up to Schultz. 5 seconds left in the game.
Over.
You believe in miracles? Yes!
Just don't know how to express their emotions now. They're just jumping around.
Unbelievable. The United States hockey team, average age 22. Herb Brooks, head coach. Craig Patrick, assistant coach. Unknown, totally anonymous, a week and a half ago. Look at Herb Brooks.
No notes tonight.
Oh, my. Jim Craig, they're still undefeated. They've got 3 points now. They've got their fate in their own hands. They'll take on Finland Sunday. The USA champ.
Oh, that's something. After the match, Coach Herb Brooks came up to our ABC commentary position for an interview. When he got there, a telephone call was waiting from a certain hockey fan in Washington, D.C. Again, Al Michaels and Ken Dryden were on the spot.
Well, thank you. I'll do that, Mr. President. Thank you, sir. Bye.
President Jimmy Carter calling with his congrats. Relate the gist of that conversation, first of all, Herb.
Well, he just said our hockey club made the whole nation very proud, and the Secretary of State just returned from Europe, and it was just a great thing to bring the American people and our dreams and our philosophies together.
Your emotions right now in what has to be the most incredible moment of a lifetime.
Well, it really is. As I told the players before, and I don't want to be philosophical, I don't want to, you know, what's the word I'm looking for? Ken is a scholar. I just told him this moment is meant to be. I said it before the game. I said, they're meant to be a hockey player. They're meant to be here at this moment. They said, the good Lord has given them this, and now let's just get it out. And we just wanted good hockey. We wanted good sportsmanship. It was, I want to sound humble and everything, but hey, it was the men against the boys. 8 years ago, they got the likes of those playing Ken Dryden. I got those kids in Pee-wees. But it's the talent they had, and they showed a lot of poise. And I just can't say, the assets of our hockey club, the players, and they deserve unbelievably, you know, all the congratulations that should be given to them.
Oh, it was just terrific, Herb. How did it happen? How did you win today?
Well, Ken, you know, you study the game, and then you need the bounces. I thought we had a pretty good game plan. It was very similar to the game plan that we had against the Czechs, the game plan that I've talked to you over the phone many times. It was something that we knew that we had to be aggressive, but if they beat us on that, we had to had a containment game in the neutral zone, stack them up, and then play with the poise and confidence and not panic. And at the end, the guys were panicking, dumping the pies. Hey, stay with what the system that got us here. Don't panic on the darn thing now. So you need the bounces, you need the luck, you need the good Lord, you need everything to beat a team like, you know, a great team like the Russians.
And of course, it's not all over, but boy, what a sweet moment to savor just for the moment. Well, the activity continues on Main Street. We told you about our visit to Jimmy's, and Jim Lampley is out on Main Street, and Jim is with three of the players who performed tonight. Jim?
I'm here in chair six with three of the 20 American hockey players here who have so much to be proud of tonight. Mike Ruzioni, John Harrington, Jim Craig. Gentlemen, one question for all of you. Sweden and Finland tied tonight. You win Sunday. The gold medal is yours. Mike?
Well, it's no question. We got to go out and we got to play 60 minutes of hockey the way we played tonight. And if we do, I'm going home with a gold.
Jimmy?
Well, if I don't let me in, we can't lose. So I just hope the hell if I can ever get a shutout, it'll be tomorrow night. Sunday.
John? I'm looking forward to it. I want to be standing up on that top one. I'm telling you, in the middle of the rink there. It's the position you wanted to be in. Good luck, gentlemen. Frank?
Okay, Jim, it's going to take some discipline. But sometime tomorrow, this young United States team will have to begin thinking about Sunday's match with Finland. The Finns tonight played Sweden in the other medal round match, and we'll have a report on that game right after this message. The medal round competition in the Olympic Games is fairly complicated. It's not fairly complicated, it's downright complicated. But the man who can sort it all out is standing at the arena right now. So let's go over to Al Michaels for an explanation.
All right, Frank, we'll discuss and we'll tell you about the medal round situation shortly. But it's hard to believe there was another hockey game played at the Ice Center tonight following the U.S.-Soviet game. There's the final score. Sweden 3 and Finland 3. Of course, to every American, it was an anticlimax, but it was an important game, obviously, to the Swedes and the Finns.
Well, it is an important game, and they have been bitter rivals over many, many years. The Finns usually the underdogs, but they've played Sweden very well, and this year they actually have a winning record against the Swedes.
3-3 tie. We're going to go back and review all of the scoring for you. It began early as Finland took a 1-0 lead just 3 minutes into the first period. They scored on this goal by number 15, Mikko Leininen, set up by Jukka Porvari. Just 3 minutes into the game, Finland had the lead, 1-0.
Well, Leininen was left wide open in the deep slot, and it was a big night for Leininen. And Leininen got two goals, and here's Porvari making the pass. He also had a big night. This was the first of two assists, and he also scored a goal. Here's the shot going through Lindbergh's legs for the 1-0 lead.
That was the entire scoring story in the first period. In the second period at the 7:06 mark, Jukka Porvari, number 25, to make it 2-0 Finland.
Well, this was the prettiest goal of the night. Porvari broke in on the right wing, and as Lindbergh went down and going across the net, he flipped it up into the top corner. Porvari has been an excellent player for Finland so far in the tournament, and he was the one who got both Finland's goals against the Soviets the other night.
However, just a couple of minutes later, Porvari went into the penalty box, and the Swedes capitalized on this power play at 10:25 of the second period. The goal by number 4, Ulf Weinstock, to make it 2-1, Finland.
Well, this is a very unfortunate play. Up to this point, the Swedes have been putting on the pressure, but were unable to score because of good goaltending by Kivala. And here on this particular play, his own defenseman, Kimmo Leinen, knocks the puck into the net.
Now, third period action, 5:24 mark. The Finns leading 2-1, but Tomas Johnson, number 2, scores for Sweden to tie the game.
This shot at first looked deflected, and certainly goaltender Lindbergh was very upset about it. But as we watch on the replay, Johnson's shot goes all the way. Kivala is upset by the positioning of the Swedish forward cutting across the crease, but the puck is in.
Then, just 50 seconds later, the Swedes able to take the lead for the first time in the game. Number 9, Mats Wallin, set up by Lennart Norberg.
Well, on a bad play in the zone, you see the flip up to Wallin, and it's just a cripple shot. He can move in on the puck, it's on its end, he can get a full slap shot on it, and very little opportunity for Kivala to stop it.
However, less than 2 minutes later, the Finns came back, and again it was number 15, Mikko Leininen, scoring his second goal to make it 3-3. So that was the final score, Sweden and Finland, ending in a 3-3 tie. And as we said before, everybody emotionally spent. A final comment, some thoughts now that you've had some time to reflect on it, the U.S.-Soviet game, one of the classics of all time, obviously.
Well, it was, and I'm sure that really reflection has to wait for tomorrow and the day after and a week after and a month after it. We're still too close to it. It was an amazing night tonight, and it was almost inconceivable that it could happen.
Well, the United States has its fate in its own hands. We're going to take a look at the standings now in the medal round. You get 2 points for a win, 1 point for a tie. Of course, points were carried in from previous games. The USA now, as you look at the current standings, with 3 points. Sweden and the Soviet Union, 2 points apiece. Finland has one. What it simply means, there are a lot of complications involved here, but very basically now, the United States with a win against Finland on Sunday at 11 o'clock would take home the gold medal. Sunday, two games to come. First of all, the U.S. taking on Finland. That game at 11 o'clock Eastern Time, and then it will be Sweden against the Soviet Union at 2:30 Eastern Time. So the United States right now in the driver's seat on their way to a possible gold medal. Okay, Frank, back to you.
It's Dorothy Hamill talks about the battle for the gold in the ladies figure skating. It'll all take place tomorrow night.
The bottlers of TAB would like to commitment and their sacrifice on the long, hard road to the Winter Games.
But there is some non-hockey and non-skiing news in Lake Placid today. In ski jumping, for instance, the final day of training took place for tomorrow's 90-meter ski jump. Chris Schenkel and Art Devlin were out on the big hill, and they called the longest training jumps of the day. Here they are.
Final practice day, number 39, is Hirokazu Yagi, silver medalist on the 70-meter hill.
Yagi off beautifully with a tremendous amount of height and floating it well down. He got a little too much weight to the right as he landed, and boy, did he pull that ski in quickly.
Art, could they be possibly over jumping the hill?
No, that's not that at all. But he did yank his knee a little. You can see that.
And, of course, we won't know till later whether that's a serious injury. Probably just a little strain.
As good a shape as these fellows are in, he gets over that overnight. His takeoff is absolutely perfect, and the way he flies, it's really marvelous. You talk about your airplane wings, there it is. Just cruising along. Boy, would I like to be on those skis right now in the shape this gentleman is in.
And to be 20 years old again, Art Devlin.
I can feel every move he's making. But I don't want to feel the one he's making now as he lands on that right leg and has to pull that left one in.
Such a beautifully contoured hill in such perfect condition. Over 300 volunteers keeping the hill in tip-top shape. But he continues to rub that knee. Hirokazu Yagi, a bank clerk from Sapporo. There you get the size of that 90-meter hill. 26 stories high is the tower. Here's Akimoto, finished fourth on the 70 hill.
Boy, he's been consistently strong all the time. A little bit rougher than his teammate, but he's still going way down. A little stiff in the landing, but nevertheless, it's a real nice jump.
Akimoto, also of Sapporo. Of course, the 72 games were on the hill there, where the Japanese swept the 70. And these two fellows want to get one of the three medals at least tomorrow. Art Devlin, through a very attractive interpreter, got a word or two from Akimoto. Let's listen.
Tell me, out of all these marvelous competitors we have here, which one do you fear the most?
Sumi.
Yeah. Sumi!
And the man Akimoto most fears in the competition tomorrow is Sumi from Switzerland. Finnish ancestry, 21 years old, has been training well here on the 90-meter hill.
He has done nothing but have long jumps all week long. Very confident. Once again, he smacks that takeoff very hard. A long, long jump, perhaps the longest of the day.
I guess it was the longest, 118 meters or 387 feet. And Art, in a matter of 11 or 12 seconds, they do it twice for the gold medal. Everything has to come into focus over that period of so few seconds.
It sure does, Chris. And he is really focusing in on that takeoff. He never seems to miss it. He jumps so hard that he gets a little play in his skis at the very beginning, and he smooths it right out, sets his eye on the transition curve, which is the very bottom of the hill, and that's what he seems to be shooting for. Just floats it all the way down there, and he comes in with a little bit of a stiff landing, which is very smart because there's a lot of pressure pulling you down when you're that far down the hill.
Hans-Jörg Sumi, 5 feet 4, 120 pounds from Gstaad, Switzerland, one of the many contenders for the gold medal tomorrow. The last day of practice saw these distances, the best 387 feet, and in the top six, the sixth was only 10 feet off the longest jump. Well, Art, you've seen a hill record broken and practice here. I know that you're sky high for tomorrow's competition.
Chris, young Sumi, who jumped 118 in his very first jump and packed up his skis and went home, tells you what's going to happen here tomorrow. Assuming the conditions are the same, and I feel they will be, with that beautiful steady updraft coming up the landing hill, you're going to see this hill record broken and a new medal winner go out of here that's going to be the best we've ever seen.
Olympic Games are for youth of the world. In figure skating, there are two 14-year-olds. But right here on the 90-meter hill, we have a teenager, a 15-year-old Ojibwe Indian from Thunder Bay named Steve Collins, who has really caught their attention.
He has the whole crowd rooting for him, and let's hope he can do well tomorrow.
Probably the most traveled of all the Olympic competitors are the ski jumpers. They go around the world several times a year. They've finished their practice. They're ready to accept the challenge of the hill tomorrow. Join us.
The 90-meter ski jump, one of the great thrills I had in Innsbruck when I was assigned to cover the 90-meter ski jump. Not the thrill of watching, the thrill when Art Devlin took me to the top of that thing. These people that do that are rather special. Another great thrill I had in Innsbruck was watching our lovely guest tonight win the gold medal in the figure skating. And Dorothy, it's great to be with us.
Good to be here.
It's been fun following you, really, your career since then. I have one question, Dorothy. I want to ask you about Annette Putsch and Linda Fratiani. What is going through their minds tonight? Linda, a little bit behind of Putsch. You've been through it. What are the feelings?
Well, I think being the underdog, you know, second place, I think Linda has the advantage because she's got nothing to lose. The 4-minute free skating is both of the girls' strong point. So for the spectators, it'll be very exciting to watch them. And I think if Linda skates her best, I really think she'll win.
You really do?
Yeah. I hope so.
What will it be that moment when they take the ice? Where is it, adrenaline flying, or what's going on in the mind?
Oh, boy. You know, when I think back on the time for me, I barely remember it. It all happened so quickly, fortunately. But I think it's really, to them, it's just another competition. We were talking about it earlier tonight. And these skaters train for the competition, and they've gone through it, and it's really just like competing in another world championship or national championship. So it's really no different. Linda's great. I think she's lucky because she's got the audience behind her. And I think that'll give her that extra something to give it all she's got.
We hope so.
Yes.
We have some tape of a special performance we had earlier by Linda Frattiani. Let's take a look at that now and keep our fingers crossed for tomorrow night. Here's Linda Frattiani. Thank you for being with us, and we'll see you tomorrow.
Thank you.
In hockey, if you need any further visual evidence, here's page one of the Albany Times Union and papers all over the country look like this today. U.S. 4, Soviet 3. It says it all. As for reaction, now the secret will come out. From TASS, the Soviet news agency, looking in the other direction, they said to lose 4-3 to the team which we not long ago defeated easily 10-3 in New York is difficult to explain. Understatement. Undoubtedly, however, they say the U.S. hockey players exerted themselves selflessly and boldly. As for the Soviet team, they say they committed gross mistakes and the goalies played unsuccessfully. True. Well, that was last night. As I said, it's unbelievable how much is yet to come. The United States conceivably could win 3 more gold medals. Eric Heiden and Linda Frattiani making her effort tonight, and the hockey team quite possibly could do that. That would be more gold medals than we've won in any Winter Olympics in history. First of all, I'm going to tell you what happened in the speed-skating race this morning. Now, some of you objected to that last week because of our basic statement that we would be not tipping off things before we showed them to you. However, we are not going to be able to show you the speed-skating race until tonight when the maximum audience is tuned in so that everybody can see it. And we feel that our basic responsibility as the primary source of news out of these Winter Olympic Games is really to let you know what's going on. So in this case, I'm going to tell you, Eric did it. He won his 5th gold medal of these games. Unprecedented. Nobody in Winter or Summer Olympic Games has ever won 5 gold medals in a single Olympics. Congratulations to him. Not only did he win the 10,000 meters, a race of almost 6 miles, but he won it by a tremendous margin, broke the world record by some 6 seconds. Now, all of the world records are set at a place called Medeo in Siberia in the Soviet Union on a lightning-fast track. It's very seldom that a world record is set anywhere but there, and he broke it by 6 seconds. Joining Mark Spitz, of course, as one of the American Olympic immortals. Mark won 7 gold medals, but he won 4 individual gold medals. The other 3 were in relays. 4 gold medals were also won by Lydia Skoblikova, a Soviet speed skater at Innsbruck in 1964, the first time ABC did the Winter Olympic Games. Nobody else has ever even won 4 in one game. So it's a great day for Eric Heiden, but so much more is to come. The live ski jumping, the women's slalom, Linda Frattiani tonight. As a matter of fact, I guess it's about time to get going. Going to go right to the biathlon relay. Fascinating subject. We're going to do it right after we take a break and then return to Lake Placid and the Winter Olympics.
Mount Van Hovenberg was filled with spectators, many waving their country's flags as the final event of biathlon. The 4x7.5 relay race was about to get underway. This is the sport requiring two extremes of body control, the steadiness it takes for expert marksmanship and the all-out effort for speed on a cross-country course. And I think it's this contrast that makes the sport of biathlon so intriguing. Now, to give yourself an idea of what the biathlete goes through, imagine running the fastest 2 miles you can possibly run over the rolling terrain, let's say, of a golf course, and then coming to a complete stop, and with your lungs heaving and your heart pounding like mad and your legs shaking, all you have to do is to delicately thread a needle 5 times in 45 seconds. I don't think there's anything quite like this in sport involving pressure and tension and discipline, and I think you're going to enjoy it. It's a mass start of this head-to-head race. There are 15 teams entered, 4 men to a team, and each man has a 9.5-pound rifle slung on his back. He will shoot twice during his 7.5-kilometer leg. The gun itself is bolt-action, single-shot, taking .22-caliber bullets. And it's an all-out sprint for the first 200 meters on the flat to try to get to the two sets of tracks that form the first portion of the course that winds its way through the woods of Mount Van Hovenberg. The skiers race for 2.5 kilometers before entering the range for the first sequence of shooting. They will shoot prone. Then they will ski 2.5 more kilometers. They'll re-enter the range and shoot standing, and then wind up with 2.5 kilometers of racing before tagging off their next teammate. The real key here is to not get carried away with the emotion of the race, to hold a good, steady, even pace. But that's very hard to do in head-to-head racing. When the competitors entered for the first time, they would be shooting in the prone position, lying on their stomachs. Here's where it almost looks like slow motion. The skiers trying to go through the recovery of oxygen to steady down for their first sequence of shooting. They go through a ritual here, getting unslung, then flipping the snow shields down, putting the clip in, and placing 3 extra bullets in the tray. 50 meters away, underneath the targets, is an area called the butts. National Guardsmen, wearing glasses to protect their eyes from shattering bullets, raise and lower the targets. To find out more about the targets themselves, here is our cross-country expert, Peter Graves.
This is the target that will be used for the prone competition. And almost unbelievably, the athletes must hit the center portion of this target, which is about the size of a silver dollar, or 4 centimeters in diameter. Now, the outer part of the target won't score a hit, but the center portion will.
This target is the one used during the standing phase of the competition. Because the standing shots are more difficult than those in the prone position, the entire 12-centimeter target is the bullseye, and any portion that's hit causes the target to fall. The targets are a distance of 50 meters from the firing line. Competitors normally fire a shot every 4 to 6 seconds. Biathletes use a special target rifle that contains a clip with 5 bullets. Although in this event, they're given 8 shots to hit 5 targets. The extra bullets are stored in the stock of the rifle or in a pocket and then emptied onto a tray at the firing line. This ski shooter has missed the target and reaches for an extra bullet, which he has to load by hand. If the biathlete leaves any target remaining, he's required to ski a time-consuming 150-meter penalty loop. This loop takes skiers about 38 seconds to complete. The biathletes are continually faced with a dilemma. Should they hurry while shooting, risking accuracy and the possibility of penalty loops, or should they take extra time to be sure they hit all the 5 targets, sacrificing valuable skiing seconds?
The early leader in the relay was Matthias Jung, number 11 of East Germany, about 10 seconds ahead of the Russian Vladimir Alekhine. Getting unslung, getting ready for the standing, and Alekhine just passed in front of the camera. So Jung knows exactly where his nearest opponent is. Gets the snow shield off, takes the flap down on the trigger finger, and is ready to fire. Now, Alekhine is on target 13, Jung is on 11. Jung has just missed on the first one. Alekhine is a notoriously fast shooter. He's got one. Takes the second one down. Misses on the next one. Has the next one down. and scores a hit on the next one, so he has one target with three bullets to shoot it. The East German on 11 is having a problem. Alekhine taking aim, and he's got it. He shoots clean and is the first one out on the course. Now, here's what puts the pressure on, because the East German knows that the Russian has left. Now, he still has two targets standing and two bullets. Got one. If he misses now, it'll force a penalty loop of 150 extra meters of skiing. He made it. So the East German heads out on the course. But he's 20.
You pay for things by...
In the history of this sport, no one has ever attained the heights of this particular athlete. Little wonder that Alexander Tikhonov has become a national hero to all of his admirers.
It could be a scene here. In the sled is one of the most successful of all the athletes in the Winter Olympics, Major Alexander Tikhonov of the Red Army. He's in his element here in the wintry woods. Tikhonov is a biathlete. You might expect a man who spends most of his time skiing and shooting in the woods to be silent, withdrawn. Not so with Alexander Tikhonov. He's a friendly, gregarious man who likes to spend a lot of time with athletes from other countries. From time to time, there have been reports that he has fallen from favor in the Soviet Union. In 1979, for example, he was demoted to the B team at the start of the season, but fought his way back and won a silver medal at the World Championships. Biathlon is a sport based on wintertime hunting. The hunter skis after his prey, then shoots it. In the games, he shoots at a target, of course. But in practice, it's sometimes otherwise. Major Tikhonov does have other interests, like going to the opera with his wife, Lyuba. Alexander Tikhonov graduated from military school at age 19 and received his commission. He has been 14 times Soviet champion, 12 times a world championship gold medalist, 3 times an Olympic gold medalist. New Year's Day is always a big occasion in the Tikhonov household because it's Daddy's birthday. He's been married for 12 years and has two sons, Alexander, who is 9, and Yevgeny, a 5-year-old, with a mind of his own. How long he can go on in the biathlon, no one really knows. After 14 years of it, he's still skiing and shooting in top form and still dedicated to the sport. Single-minded, you might say. For example, when asked what his hobbies are, his answer was simple and direct. Hunting, he said.
And here is the hunter, Tikhonov, in the Olympics. When he came to the range to shoot for the first time, he held a 25-second lead over the East German. Watch Tikhonov's preparation to shoot, just like clockwork. No wasted motions, no seconds squandered, and all the time regaining breath control and composure to shoot. He's got one. Two down. Three in a row, two to go on a 4-centimeter target. About as big as a silver dollar, and he's got it. Tikhonov shoots clean, putting tremendous pressure on Siebert, knowing that Tikhonov had shot clean and off racing again. Siebert, 3 in a row. A miss. Another miss. He had to go to the extra bullets and load each one laboriously by hand. 3 bullets to hit 2 targets. Two to make one. This is what takes the discipline. Don't rush it. He missed again. One to make one. Another miss. And he would have to go a penalty loop. unbearable tension here. He did miss, showing it can happen to a world champion. 2.5 kilometers later, Tikhonov re-entered the range for the standing portion of his shooting. Nailed the first one. Missed on two. Got another one. Another miss. Two targets still up. He has three bullets to make two. He's been down this route before. He's used to the tension. Uh-oh. Now, it does get tense. Two to make two. One to go, and one bullet left. And Tikhonov shoots clean. The East German was just beginning to shoot. He entered 53 seconds behind Tikhonov, but Tikhonov took another 15 to 20 seconds with those extra three shots. The East German now had a chance, but Siebert had to use all eight shots, and one target was left. Another punishing penalty lap for the East German. That disaster wasn't nearly as bad as the Czech athlete, Jaromír Siminek, who broke a sling on his rifle, causing him to have to pole with one hand, carrying the rifle in the other. He would have to make an unscheduled stop for repairs. The United States team had been holding pretty steadily in sixth place. Skiing the third leg was their best biathlete, Don Nielsen, a magna cum laude graduate of Dartmouth. He shot clean and the crowd roared. The United States was 11th at Innsbruck, definitely optimistic about a higher finish here. The team, Martin Hagen, Lyle Nelson, Don Nielsen, and Peter Hoge. On the final lap, Eberhard Rösch of East Germany on the left had started out 39 seconds behind the Russian anchorman, Anatoly Alibiev, the gold medalist of the grueling 20-kilometer event held earlier. But Rösch's strong skiing had gained 11 precious seconds on the Russians. Alibiev, shooting target 13. On target 11, Rösch. Rösch missed on the first. Alibiev missed. The tension beginning to build here in the final stages. Alibiev using all eight bullets, but he shot clean. Rösch had three to make one. Miss. Now two to make one. He nailed it. So he picked up another 8 seconds on the Russian and again takes off in pursuit of the Soviet athlete. When they returned for the final standing shots, the East Germans were only 39 seconds behind, and by odd coincidence, that's about the amount of time it takes for a penalty loop to be run. Everything hinged on a clean score here. Alibiev taking his time. East German getting ready to shoot. Alibiev on 13, the East German on 11. One down for the Russian. Two down. Miss on three. He's got another one. East German has missed the first two, and the Russian has one target remaining. Three bullets left. He's got it. And now, the East German has three bullets left to make three. A clean score could mean that he could catch the Russian in the cross country. Now, two to make two. A miss. The gold was gone. Another miss could cost the silver because the West German team was closing fast. He made it. But one target was still up and all of his bullets were gone. That forced a penalty loop. But at least the silver was saved and the Russians were ecstatic. Alibiev crossed the finish line, giving the Soviets their fourth straight gold medal in this event. Their jubilation was spontaneous and there was no hiding their emotions. The ultimate in Russian praise, tossing their heroes in the air. Alexander Tikhonov had been there before. The Soviet Union won the gold. The East Germans took the silver. West Germany took the bronze. For the first time in history, no medals to the Scandinavians. For the Americans, an eighth place finish. They were happy.
Live coverage of the 90 meter ski jump from Intervale. Out at Intervale, they're almost ready for the 90-meter ski jump. In fact, they're beginning to send down the four jumpers who are sort of like test pilots to try out the run. We'll be going out for the competition very shortly. While we have a few minutes, however, we're going to check in with Don Meredith, our man around Lake Placid. He went out on Mirror Lake and found a fascinating story.
But all the kids in and around Lake Placid have tickets to the downhill races or the ice skating rink. But they seem to be doing all right on their own. They're what they call a three-dimensional ice rink. It's something that you do in a playground, something that you do if this was maybe a baseball park, a baseball field. They've created what they call their world's only three-dimensional ice rink, three-dimensional functional art. I can't say that the idea originally came from East Texas, but I can say the guy who's behind it came from about 20 miles from Mount Vernon in Pittsburgh, Texas, and I'd like for you to meet Marvin Clark. Marvin, I know we didn't have that much snow in East Texas and very little ice either, but that is kind of your hometown. How in the world did you get involved with this three-dimensional art and, as you say, functional sculpture?
Well, about 12 years ago, we moved to Troy, New York, and we found a lot of ice and a lot of snow, and we just thought it'd be a good thing to have a lot of fun with it. So we started building these ice rinks in our backyard.
And you're here as, what, a special part of the Art Commission, is that right?
Yes, the National Fine Arts Committee of the 1980 Olympics is sponsoring this program here.
Well, now your boy Dan, I saw out here, he was doing some of these tricks. Are you a pretty good skater yourself?
No, I'm not much of a skater. I'm afraid I'd break my leg, and I don't want to miss a season of watching these operations. So I stay off the skates. That's for the younger crowd.
Is this the kind of thing that you think would this be something that maybe some of the other people could do themselves, or are they fairly easy to build? So could you get in the backyard, pile up some snow? How did you actually build it?
Yes, one of the main reasons we're here is to try to demonstrate that this sort of thing can be done in any neighborhood that has cold weather. So we are trying to show how to build these ice rinks, how people can go back home and have one in their own neighborhood.
I think that's a good idea, and the folks at the Olympics have also proved that if it doesn't snow, you can make the snow. So maybe you can make your own ice rink, too. Marvin, thank you for being with us.
Thank you.
Jumping Hill, best in the world, groomed for the 50 best ski jumpers from 17 nations. That 90-meter tower on the right looms 500 feet above the outrun. And from the top, the jumpers try to get all the speed they can on an in-run that measures 350 feet in length. From the takeoff, they want to go more than 360 feet through the air. The jumpers from 17 countries have the shortest performance of any of the Olympic competitors because each jump lasts about 12 seconds. But during those few seconds, it's a test of control, skill, daring, guts, and grace. And a man that knows what I'm talking about is America's finest ski jumper and our oldest commentator and point of service, Art Devlin. What must these jumpers do here today to win a gold, silver, and bronze?
Well, Chris, each jumper gets two competitive jumps, and they both score. There are five judges. The high and low are thrown out. And you take the distance points and the style points, and you total them together, and the man with the highest number of points is the winner.
You've always been a good pick'em man. You've come up with the 1, 2, 3 in past telecasts, so right here, I'm going to put you on the spot. Give me the top three.
Well, based on the training which we have seen in the 90-meter hill all week long, Hans-Jörg Suomi from Switzerland sticks out like a sore thumb. He's been consistently long and very loose.
He's a 21-year-old Swiss of Finnish ancestry, very loose. Here's another loose man from Japan, 23-year-old Akimoto.
He has been very good. He does not have the experience of Mr. Suomi, but watch out for this young Japanese boy.
And here's a 19-year-old Austrian.
Hubert Neuper, he has done it all this winter in Europe. He won the Springer Tourney. He has a lot of experience and a very tough competitor.
Art, perhaps you can show us and talk us through what each of these 50 jumpers tries to do on that long, graceful in-run.
Here in the model of our 90-meter ski jump, we have a movable platform. And once the starting position is determined, the ski jumper will start at the top. And as he starts down this 35-degree incline, he will accelerate to about 35 or 40 miles an hour. And as he gets closer to the takeoff, The degree will change, and he will be doing about 60 miles an hour as he goes off this 11-degree hang at the takeoff. Now, right here, if he jumps early, he's in trouble, and if he jumps late, he's in trouble. But if he hits it on the button, he will fly all the way down here, probably about 120 meters, and have a beautiful jump.
And now this live shot from Intervale, about a mile and a half from the village of Lake Placid, New York. And Art Devlin, just about as the crow flies a half a mile from the ABC Television Center. It was a gray day, but now we're seeing some blue sky. Look at it above that 90-meter jump. Some sunshine is coming out now as we go to the first jumper. He's the youngest of the four Japanese competitors here today. You're looking at him now at the top of the hill, 18 years old, a native of Hokkaido, a university student. He's gaining experience, but will you see his teammates named Yagi and Akimoto? This is the 90-meter hill, the final of three jumping competitions during these 13th Winter Olympic Games. The 70 was conducted on the adjacent hill, along with the combined jumping portion of that event. Now, it's for gold, silver, and bronze. Two jumps. Number one, Ayazawa.
Have lowered the speed because of those trial jumps. Ayazawa off very smoothly. There's still plenty of speed in the hill.
Ayazawa not expected to go too far, but it appears that he has come through with a jump of 95 meters, which would be 312 feet. 312 for Ayazawa of Japan. Next up will be a many-time Swiss champion. He did not jump in the 70-meter competition. His name is Carl Lustenberger. He was 19th in the Olympic Games at Innsbruck 4 years ago. He once won at Holmenkollen. 27 years old, electrician. He's ready.
And remember, these early jumpers are not particularly the best. They give you a good idea of the speed. Now he's off with a lot of height, and he's going down the hill with a long jump. The speed is in the track. You can be sure we're going to have a new record.
98 meters for Lustenberger of Switzerland, and that's 322 feet. And Art, you mentioned practice jumps. We had some long ones. Each was allowed one official jump. Earlier today, we had Steve Collins with 114 meters. He's the young Indian from Canada. And at the top of the hill, this is Johann Malanig, a customs officer, one of the four Austrians who have a real chance, including Tony Inar, who won the gold medal on the 70-meter hill. This 27-year-old is on the track.
And Malanik is a long jumper. He'll give us an indication of the speed. Malanik off very well, having a little problem over the nose. He'll back in and save what could have been a disastrous leap.
97 meters or 318 feet. What do you mean he had trouble, Art?
He jumped a bit early. He got the tips down. He snapped them right back, and then he just floated it on down.
And now the cheers you hear down around the outrun where there are some 20,000 people once the sun comes out. It's for Walter Momquist of Post Mills, Vermont, who finished 12th. There are the two American cheerleaders trying to excite the crowd here and get them with it. And after last night's hockey victory over the Soviet Union, these fans are fired up here at the ski jumping complex today. Momquist finished 12th in the combined. Let's see what he does on this 90-meter hill.
And remember that this gentleman's been running cross-country this week, and he is a little tired in his leg. Walter's a powerful jumper. He gets off very smoothly, and he's pressing it on down. A very nice jump for Walter Momquist.
And it appears it's 97 meters or 318 feet for the 23-year-old Dartmouth College graduate. And he'll probably compete more and hopefully be in Yugoslavia in 4 years. Walter Momquist, the first of the United States jumpers. There are four United States jumpers. As we go to the top now, here's a 26-year-old bachelor electrician from Norway, Ivar Mobeck. Finished 26th in the 70-meter competition here at Intervale. There are 50 starters from 17 nations. This is the first from Norway.
He's off very well and not quite up to par for what his training was, but it's a nice jump.
So the early indication is 99 meters, 325 feet. So we've had a couple of jumpers that have gone 99, including the first man, Ayazawa of Japan. That was Mobeck of Norway. And now added to the 90-meter East German team, we watched him in Europe, is this 23-year-old student, Harold Duschek. And he can jump. National championships, he's won it once. He's been twice, two times. And third, three times. And let me tell you, in East Germany, they have 10 jumpers that could make any team in the world. This is one of them, Duschek.
and I predict he will go over 100. The East German team extremely strong. They were not as good in training as the other jumpers, but in the practice round before this competitive jump, every one of them was right down over 100 meters.
Having a little trouble pulling the trigger. Checking his bindings once more. Bill Mayer, the start judge.
I'll do
the assistant up there is Larry Stone.
Checking his equipment, making
not trying to get the fog off those goggles. And you'll see many colored the lenses on these goggles, Art. Some are clear, some are amber, some are gray, and very, very dark.
The most popular is amber, you know, the little yellow glow. Now, Duchek will give us a good idea what the speed is. Duchek has a lot of height, and he's going on down the hill, but he did not catch the last part of his glide at all.
No, as a matter of fact, he only got 95 meters in flight. And at 95 meters, that's 312 feet. He is the shortest jumper thus far. Well, Duchek has one more, like all the 50. Two jumps judged on style and distance. By five international judges, the high and low are thrown out. Aggregate points are totaled. That's the way the medalists will be determined here this afternoon. We're live at Intervale. Hubert Neuper is going to be coming up very, very soon at about three jumps. He's a 19-year-old youngster that won this year's Springer Tournee, a combination of four events in Germany and Austria. Art Devlin, who has gotten to know this young man very, very well, had a chance to stop and visit with Hubert.
What do you do, actually, before you step into that track?
At first, I get up. And then I go to make spots. And after this, breakfast, and then massieren, masseur.
The masseur?
Yeah. And then it's time to go out to the hill and to warm up here. And then make the trial jump. And after this, the competition.
Hubert, what did you mean by after you get up, you're going to make sports? Does that mean you're going to go jogging, run around the lake or something?
Yeah, a little run and gymnastic for wake up.
How far approximately would you run? Would you run all the way around the lake?
No, that's too far. I'm tired and I can't jump. I run about 1 mile, 1 mile, and then between I make gymnastics.
Tell me, Hubert, what will you actually have for breakfast? What type of food?
We have some fats. Healthy food we eat. Wheat and fruits there and yogurt. That's special food. We get strong.
All right, there you see some of the 20,000 spectators, a much sought-after ticket. You're looking at the standing, the general admission area. Look at them. Every color imaginable is sort of a green sun now hitting them. And it's about 20 degrees out here with very little wind, but there is that updraft on the hill that all these jumpers want. And Art, what would you say today? A couple of jumps of 112 or 13 meters will win the gold?
Very likely, but if they leave the track right where it is and don't change that speed, they could very easily go 120.
All right, Hubert Neuper, the man Art Devlin was talking to, the 19-year-older who won the last international championship. He won two of the four events. Total points, was the overall champion. Now on the 90, his first of two jumps, Neuper.
And he's getting a little updraft in this landing hill, which is ideal. It's coming right from the transition curve slowly up this hill. But now we'll see if Hubert can lay out over that wind.
Longest jump thus far is 100.
And Hubert has a lot of height, and he's stretching it on down there.
Oh! He was in the red area.
About 113. Boy, that's some jump.
And 113 is translated into 371 feet. Imagine, Art, longer than an American football field.
Oh, baby, and is he a competitor or isn't he?
He is the leader.
And look at him here now in slow motion. You can see he got a hold of his takeoff beautifully. He's in the perfect wing position, gliding on down into that landing hill, and he just takes it like apple pie.
We'll return to the 90-meter hill following this.
If you missed the recent Delco battery sale, here's great news. AC Delco slashes its regular prices on the three most powerful automotive Delco Freedom batteries. Freedom is the original, never-add-water, maintenance-free battery. It's powerful, dependable, and it's from Delco. Check Delco Freedom battery prices where quality AC Delco parts are sold and take advantage of our reduced regular price. You'll say thanks, Delco.
Mom, we got a present for you.
When you get home.
Let's go.
You can install the Stanley do-it-yourself garage door opener in about 4 hours. Everything comes in the box. Just assemble it, put it up, and plug it in.
Surprise.
The Stanley do-it-yourself garage door opener.
Push it.
It's a very nice thing to do for somebody else.
He did it so fast.
We want to help you do things right. Stanley, we want to help you do things right.
Back again in our exclusive coverage, we are live at Intervale, which is the ski jumping complex. This is the final event for the jumpers. 50 of the best in the world from 17 nations. Kawabata, a Japanese jumper, just went 102 and a half meters, but the leader is Hubert Neuper of Austria, 371 feet. Here is Horst Ballou, only 17 years old, from the Canadian team, a comer.
He's a teammate of little Stevie Collins. He's also a long jumper. He doesn't hit it quite as well as he can hit it, but a smooth jump.
And a student from Ottawa, Canada. Get some applause from the blue and yellow uniformed officials here, over 300 of them. The markers, let's see what they gave him. They gave him 100 meters on the nose. That's 328 feet. And as we said, he is only 17 years old. He's coached by an American named Billy Bakke. Their team manager, Fred Morris, has done a great job with this Canadian team. And later, you're going to see the youngest member of these group of jumpers named Stevie Collins, a 15-year-old Ojibwe Indian. Here is number 13, and 13 is Roger Rude of Norway, a veteran. Might surprise us today.
All the Norwegians are very, very consistent. He is a lot of height on the takeoff, and now he's dropping in behind the hill with a nice long jump.
or 3 meters short of Rupert Neuper, and 110 is 361 feet. So, Art, we've had two jumps now, long ones, 113 for Neuper, 110 in meters for Roger Rude.
You know, we neglected to say that the new hill record set by Hubert Neuper is 113. The old one is 111, set last year by Pentti Kokkonen.
But in practice, yesterday we had a 118-meter jump by Sumi, whom you'll see later. This is Egloff of Switzerland.
And Egloff with a lot of height, but he got on a little bit too early, but he pulled it back beautifully, and that could have been a dangerous one.
Art, how did those little blue ribbons show coming up the hill? Is the updraft working okay for
it? It is perfect. This is what they depend upon.
All right, Jari Pukkanen. As we replay the jump of Egloff of Switzerland.
You can see he was a bit early. Now those tips are going to go down on him, and he has to pull back for all he's worth. Right here. See the tips go down, and now he's backpedaling for everything he can make out of it.
And Jari Pukkanen, one of the strong Finn jumpers, a 20-year-old student from Lahti.
And the Finnish flyer has a lot of height, and he's going way down the hill. Another beautiful long jump. About 110, I'd say.
Yes, it's 110 meters for Pukkanen of Finland, and that's 361 feet. It's a beautiful day now here, probably the prettiest day that we've had in a week or so here at Intervale, the ski jumping complex. All right, that's the 70-meter hill on the left. They're using the 90. Here is Reed Zolke of the United States, a 19-year-old native of Eau Claire, Wisconsin. Strong with a quick leg thrust at the takeoff. He'll need that today to get into the competition.
I used to jump against his dad, and I'm sure he's watching today and very proud of his son. And Reed gets off a little bit early. He's handling it okay. Undoubtedly very tense. First time in the competition.
All right, 98 meters or 322 feet. For 19-year-old Reed Zolke, one of the hopes for the future of the United States jumping team. You saw in the background a moment ago the foreign press and commentator booths down at the very end of this long and safe outrun. American flags everywhere, every color of clothing that you can imagine out here. But the temperature is 20 degrees. There's very little wind because ski jumping hills are always bordered by native trees. Here you have the white birch, the balsam fir, the spruce. As we look at Malusiak of Poland. He's a 22-year-old vocational student and an electrician. His sporting rank in Poland, first class.
Chris, bear in mind that these early jumpers are not supposed to be the better jumpers, and look how far they're going. Now the Polish boy has a lot of height, but he climbs too much and he drops in early.
91 meters, his measurement, or 299 feet. Four groups, and the coaches then sprinkle their as many as four jumpers within the four groups. Then a computer draw is done. They aren't really seated, but you'll see that the greater jumpers will be coming later here, Art, when that track will be mighty fast.
Boy, it tells me that someone is going to go very close to 120.
Now at the top on that 350-foot in run, where they attain speeds of between 60 and 65, his occupation military, West Germany. His name is Hermann Weinbach, a junior world champion in Nordic combined. His father is head of the West German Ski Federation, as we have just a slight delay at the top. He was 21st in the world championship at Lahti, plays soccer and tennis, his first Olympic Games, so the 19-year-older should be ready to get out of the blocks up there at the top and glide down that track. And doesn't it look narrow? You'll see that there, it has a border on each of the two sides. Those are balsam little seedlings to give some definition to the end run.
Absolutely, a little comparison. And this youngster gets off a little late, just seesawing through the air, not too good a jump.
85 All right, that was Hermann Weinbach of West Germany. And 85 meters, or 279 feet. Not bad for his first Olympics. Remember to get two jumps, all 50 jumpers.
I'll tell you, hang on to your hat now.
Oh, yes.
Henry Glass coming up, and he could really set the stage for what the big boys are going to do, because he's one of them himself.
Well, he won a bronze at Innsbruck 4 years ago as ABC covered those Olympic Games. He won a silver at the 78 World Cup. He's 27 years old. Just turned 27 last week, and he loves this hill. He was 15th on the 70-meter hill. So let's see what this jumper, who has a hobby of motorcycling, can do on the 90-meter hill. Live from Innervale. Two starters, as we said. You're looking at Bill Mayer and Larry Stone up there, and they will not get the go-ahead, a voice signal. There's also a stoplight, red and green, which tells them when to go, and then you'll hear an all-clear horn signal.
See, he obviously is concentrating a little bit, and he will not go until he just feels exactly right. There's something bothering him. Not normal to stay there so long. He may have one of his teammates watching that updraft, waiting to see if it gets a little bit better.
Yeah, halfway on the contoured hill, Art, I noticed that the blue ribbons are just hanging there, dangling there, while way down near the landing area, they are going in a direction.
And now they're in the direction he wants. Okay. That's what he's been waiting for. You can bet your life that's what it was. He got a lot of height over the nose, but it didn't do him too much good. He jumped up too much.
98 and a half meters for Henry Glass, who was told by his coach to hold it up. Now, they have a reasonable length of time to hold up. That was a little longer than I have seen them held up in a while, Art, but that is the rule. The coaches contact radio contact here, can get word to them to wait for that updraft coming up the hill. And here's one of the Soviet Union, Ivanov.
And Ivanov with a lot of height. And he's down around 98 or so.
97 meters for Yuri Ivanov of the Soviet Union, or 318 feet. Peter Leitner has had some good practice jumps. He's born in Oberstdorf, where they have a great jumping hill. He's from West Germany, of course. He's on the end run, Art, ready to fly.
And Peter Leitner won the 70-meter jump here last year. And Peter has a lot of height and a very smooth jump, down around 100 meters.
I saw a hand go on the 106-meter disc, Art. We'll have to wait to see what it is. It is 106 meters or 348 feet for Peter Leitner. He is currently fourth. From Austria, Hubert Neuper is in the lead with 113 meters. And now, here's a silver medalist on the 70-meter hill. He tied with Deckert of East Germany, Hirokazu Yagi. He throws caution to the wind. 20 years old, a bank clerk from Sapporo, Japan.
And if Yagi catches it, look out. Yagi with a lot of height, a nice smooth jump. He did not get the takeoff perfectly at all.
Surprisingly short for Yagi. 96 meters. We say short. Well, as compared to the top jump thus far here in the first round of jumps, 113 meters, so 317 feet. You're watching live the finals of the 90-meter competition. We'll return following this.
The Boeing 747, the Boeing 727, the Boeing 707, the Boeing 737, and soon two new airplanes, the 757 and the 767. The Boeing family, the world's favorite way to fly.
It isn't such a big world.
See!
All the places and the faces.
Feel!
All the loving and the laughter.
Bring it all together and you'll see the world feels a whole lot better when the people of the world all get together.
Boeing jetliners have done more to jet the world together than anything ever made by man.
The world feels a whole lot better when we all get together.
You're looking at the wide and snow-covered outrun. That's after they land here on the 90-meter ski jumping competition for the gold, silver, and bronze today. We're in the first round of jumps. 50 jumpers from 17 nations. One of the finest fields ever assembled for any Winter Games. We go back up to the top of the hill, and it looks like it's number 25. This is Per Bergerud of Norway, a 23-year-old electrical engineering student. He has had some dramatic falls in the past, causing serious injuries, but he seems to be coming back after each fall. He's a bachelor, and this is his first jump in two. Per Bergerud.
And Pear with a tremendous amount of height and stretching it well down the hill, well into the hundreds also.
108 meters for Per Bergerud of Norway. There you see the translation into feet, 354 feet. And while we were away, Jaakko Tormonen of Finland cracked one for 114 and a half meters. 114 and a half, which is about 376 feet. So Neuper now is second, Kukkonen is third, Rude is fourth, and Leitner is fifth. This is Miran Tepes of Yugoslavia, who finished 44th on the 70-meter hill out of 47 competitors. He's an 18-year-old student gaining experience. On the far side, as we look from the left, the distance judges are situated 1 meter apart as we look at Stanislav Bobak of Poland.
And Bobak's heels hit first and threw him on down a little bit further. That's a strange one.
And we see one of the distance judges put his hand on the disc, which says 104. This is the way ski jumping is measured in distance. Style points provided by five international judges. 112.3. Currently, Polish jumper has moved up. There are the meter markers, the yellow discs, and in the blue and yellow uniforms, 300 volunteers from the ski jumping hills around the United States. This is Keiko of Canada, the oldest competitor, 29 years of age.
And a very popular fellow here in Lake Placid.
Completed even in the Sapporo Olympics in 1972 as a member of the Finnish Olympic team, where he finished fourth on the 90-meter hill. He's an aluminum siding installer, and today he jumped in his first of two, 98 meters. All right, here is Manfred Deckert, who had long practice jumps, a man that tied for the silver on the 70-meter hill, only 18 years old, youngest of the East Germans.
And as we've been saying, the East Germans never seem to miss it. Although he was a little bit early, he had the pullback. It'll cost him a lot of style points.
So thus far, the East German jumpers have not really finished up in the top 10 because a Finn, Tormonen, is in the lead. From Austria, Neuper is second. Kukkonen from Finland is third. Rude of Norway is fourth. And fifth is his teammate, Per Bergerud. 29, Manfred Deckard. Worth looking at once
more. Now you can see here, Deckard jumped way too early. The tips dropped right down on him. Now he has to get him back, and he's seesawing through the air, pulling out the best he can. But that early takeoff is always disaster.
And back up at the top of the hill with his bib number 30, he has gone off. It was Gerard Collin of France, a 21-year-old jumper, who finished 35th. And now we're looking at one of the four Soviet Union jumpers, Alexei Borovitin, won the national championship twice, third in the world championship, first at Lahti in 77 and at Holman Collin. And, well, he's one of their better jumpers, at least from the experience standpoint. He was 26 years old Valentine's Day. Following him will be Jim Denny of the United States.
And Borovitin off a little early, has to pull it back, and this shortens the jump.
Borovitin of the Soviet Union. 91 and a half meters for Borovitin, and our eyes will be going up to the top of the hill because Jim Denny, America's hope for a medal. Pre-Olympic trials, he finished third behind the world's greatest. So now this 22-year-old, his last competition, probably this is it. First of two jumps for Jim Denny, oldest of four brothers from Duluth, Minnesota. Really, back a good one.
Got to be a lot of cotton in his mouth, Chris. Jimmy hits it very well, pushing it on down the hill. That's a beautiful jump from Jimmy. He's back to his old style. About 110, I'm not sure about.
I see a hand on the 109-meter disc on the far side of the contoured hill. 109 meters. And that puts Jim Denny up in the top six. The leader is Holmanen with 114 and a half meters. Neuper with 113. Kukkonen, 110 and a half. Denny, 109. He is in fourth position.
And Jimmy cracked it absolutely on the button, and he's showing the old style he had here last year.
But hold the phone. The gold medal winner on the 70-meter hill, the talented Tony Inar of Austria, that 21-year-older who won the silver medal on the 90-meter hill in his home of Innsbruck 4 years ago. Here's Inar.
And this boy has experience. And he has beautiful height, and he's stretching it on down, but not as far as any, I don't think. Yeah, about the same, I guess. Beautiful jump.
Denny with 109, and it appears that it may have been 110 meters or 1 meter longer for the gold medalist on the 70-meter hill, Tony Inar. 110 meters. Number 34. Currently fourth, Denny now is fifth. Denny of the United States. Here's why he went 110.
You can see that Tony Inar has it exactly where he wants it. Got his body in the perfect position and floats it on down to a beautiful landing.
We'll return with more spectacular jumps after this.
Release. Release. Discover new moisture release beauty treatments for the face and body from Revlon. Moisture Release. Blended inside this rich moisturizing cream are tiny capsules of fresh moisturizers. Together they work with your skin to replenish moisture, to renew moisture. Moisture Release, for skin that looks and feels renewed hour after hour. Moisture Release, exclusively from Revlon.
Just got it, a Chevrolet Monte Carlo with a turbocharged V6. I looked at a Datsun A10 and a VW Scirocco. But you know, I got lots more room, darn good mileage, and on top of that, I also got turbocharging. More room, good mileage, turbocharged performance. No foreign car can give you that combination at a Chevrolet price. Monte Carlo's got it.
Now we've got it.
Yeah, Chevy's got it. Just come get it. And get a brand new Chevrolet.
Tuesday, Laverne and Shirley get back together with Fonzie and the whole gang. Once again, they're back-to-back with Happy Days when Chachi finally puts the move on Joni.
Have a good time.
But gets a warning.
But not too good, bucko.
Not to fly too high. Then, Laverne and Shirley take a blood-curdling ride on the Moose Jaw Express.
She's gone! She's gone!
Who done it? To Shirley.
Tuesday on ABC.
There's America's Jim Denny, best of the American jumpers thus far here in the first round with 109 meters. He's in fifth position behind the leader, Tormanen of Finland. Neuper is second of Austria. Kukkonen of Finland is third. Inar of Austria is fourth. We've just had a Swedish jumper that jump too early, Art, and what a spill he took down the contoured hill while Jim Denny signs autographs. We're going to look here now at Jan Holmland. Watch.
Now, there's your early takeoff for you. There's a front flip. That is the thing that all ski jumpers dread the most, that early takeoff. The pressure gets on the tip of those skis, and it's goodbye.
And Art, it looked like the brunt of his weight on the scapula, the top of his back. Let's look at it again. Jan Holmland of Sweden. We'll try to get a report at our first opportunity. Just what
here he goes.
The
pressure's right on the top of them. You'd think he was trying to purposely do a somersault here. Now we'll see how he handles as he goes into the landing hill. Now let me tell you, if this landing hill were not hard, this man would be injured terribly. But the hill is hard, so he keeps right on moving. He doesn't dig in. So consequently, as long as he keeps sliding like this, there's a very good chance he's only going to come out of it with a sore back.
And several bounces, Art, on his back. And let's see, did both skis stay on? Yes, they did. He went down there many, many meters, and he is down at the flat portion, the beginning of the outrun. After they glide down the contoured hill, he's being administered to now by many of the medical people here, some of the 300 volunteers, ski jumping experts from 25 states. They're helping to conduct this event, the second big event on this 90-meter hill, as last year, late, there was a pre-Olympic trial on the 90-meter hill, which was won by Pentti Kokkonen, who's going to be jumping next. But right now, we have a delay in the jumping because we'll have to repair a few of the spots, maybe on the hill. And Jan Holmland of Sweden, a bachelor, 22 years old, is being carried from the outrun here. And we'll try to get a report for you at our first opportunity. And our safety is built into these hills. Not only the hills themselves, the in-run, the contoured hill, and the out-run, but the talented people that conduct the ski jumping. They take no chances. You know, the skis that we saw remain on Holmland are over 8 feet long. They are very different than those of cross-country and alpine. Art Devlin makes a comparison for you.
We have here the three types of skis that are used in Olympic competition. The first ski, the alpine ski, is about 6 feet long. It weighs maybe five and a half to 6 pounds. The cross-country ski, 6.5 feet long, weighs maybe 1.5 to 2 pounds per ski. Big Daddy, the jumping ski, is about 8 foot 3 inches long and weighs anywhere from 8.5 to 9 pounds per ski. Now, the width of the alpine ski is about 3.5 to 4 inches. The cross-country ski, very narrow, maybe 2 inches at the very most, 1.75 inches. Now, the jumping ski, the heavy baby, that's about 5.5 inches wide. Now, let's just take a look at the three types of boots used. The first one, the alpine boot, very, very rigid. And in the binding, they cannot lift the heel. This is so the alpine skier can control the ski, which is all edging. It's a very stiff boot, very strong. Now, the cross-country boot, very, very flexible. Has to be able to lift his heel, a lot of running. And it's a light shoe, hardly weighs anything, almost like a tennis shoe. Now, the jumping boot, which looks very much like the alpine boot, is also very flexible, like the cross-country boot. See how this one flexes? The old boots used to flex like this, but they stopped right here. Now, what the jumper is doing, he's got an alpine touch to the back of his boot. Now, when he gets on the takeoff and he rolls forward, that boot helps keep him go forward and lift that tip of the ski up, which is what he wants. Another thing it does, if you should happen to sit back in the landing, that boot has a tendency to pop you right back up on your feet.
Okay, thank you very much, Art Devlin. Capacity crowd here at Intervale. We have a delay in the official competition because of a somersaulting fall of Jan Holmland. The preliminary medical report sent up to us is that he is not seriously injured, but now the jumps are underway. Pentti Kokkonen, one of the great Finns.
And Pev Kokkonen had his problems, too. He was early, but being an old-timer, he got those skis back and just stood there, or you would have seen another one on that spot.
And his teammate, 25-year-old Joukko Tormanen, is in the lead, 114.5 meters. Neuper of Austria, second. Pukkanen, third. Inauer of Austria, fourth. And Jim Denny of the United States is in fifth at this moment as we're going down near the end now of the first rounds of jumps. Herbert Schwartz competed in the 70-meter competition, finished 25th. He was in the Nordic combined, finished ninth. And this 19-year-old bachelor now in the 90-meter in-run.
And Schwartzoff very smoothly, not a particularly powerful jumper, but he executes a beautiful jump.
All right!
Should be somewhere in the area of the 104 meters. There you see the foreign broadcast booths as ABC technically are providing the world with the pictures from these 13th Olympic Games. Currently 10th with... What measurement did they give him? Now, let's don't worry about Schwartz because here's the favorite. 118 meters in practice yesterday, one jump and went home. Hans-Jörg Suomi of Switzerland.
And Suomi with a little problem here and a lot of height is still going way downhill. There's a very long jump. Boy, this kid can handle it.
The leader was Jukko Tormanen of Finland. Hans-Jörg Suomi is number 39 of Gstaad, Switzerland. An apprentice plumber. 117 meters, Art. 384 feet. He is the new leader. So that drops the American Denny back to sixth. Suomi is on top.
Now you can see he jumped so hard that at this point he's rough. See those skis going back and forth? But he's got it exactly where he wants it, and now he's stretching his body out over it, and he's getting a beautiful updraft. And he's just laying on that pressure. That's exactly what these jumpers want. Takes the landing a little stiff because he's way down there.
Well, it's just like they're on a pillow of air floating down. And 39, skis on his shoulders.
After that,
as Art told you, weigh about 18 or 19 pounds, and they have to climb up 276 steps to the elevator. Jeff Davis has come out of the elevator. He's now at the start. He's from the United States, had 91 meters on the 70-meter hill the other day. It was a race because they were overjumping the hill. It did not count. He's a 21-year-old high school graduate from Steamboat Springs, Colorado. Finished 17th in the 70-meter competition. His teammate, Jim Denny, is in sixth position behind Suomi, Tormanen, and Neuper, Pukkanen, and Enauer.
And remember, Davis has had very few jumps in the 90s. But he gets off very smoothly, but he's not pushing very hard. A little bit nervous.
Well, he's 21 years old, perhaps he'll be in Yugoslavia 4 years from now. 315 feet for Jeff Davis. Added to the 90-meter team of the powerful East German team, Klaus Oswald from Klingenthal, East Germany. 21 years old. He is a great jumper, and he could do a job here today. Suomi of Switzerland in the lead.
And Oswald has a lot of headwind. He's laying on it. Not up to par with the rest of the East Germans.
1-7, not too bad.
107.
So for the East Germans, they're finally going to get up into the top 10. And this is a real surprise here in this first round of jumps. We're going to leave now in our live coverage from Intervale. But we'll be back here for some of the greats of the ski jumping world after this. Metropolitan really stands by you.
1, 2, 3. Glad I'm insured by Metropolitan, because Metropolitan will really stand by me.
Metropolitan really stood by me, so now I have the dream house I always dreamed of.
Two daughters, double wedding. Metropolitan really stood by me.
For insurance for life, home, car, health, and retirement.
Metropolitan really stands by you. Many-time champion Johan Setra. He's from Norway. Switzerland is in the lead. Hans-Jörg Suomi. A Finn is second and Austrian is third. Here's Satre's jump.
Satre normally very stylish, has a lot of height, but he's just pushing a little too much here. Not anywhere near as far as he normally could jump here.
Along with the other jumpers, this seven times Norwegian champion will be able to do it again a little bit later on. Johan Setra, 318 feet. Now, Akimoto is one of the top Japanese jumpers, wearing that big number 44 on his bib here on the 90-meter hill. This is a live shot at the start, at the beginning of a 350-foot in-run where they reach speeds of 60 or 65 miles an hour, then take off. Longest jump, 117 meters. Let's see what Akimoto can do to erase it.
And Akimoto off with a lot of height and pushing it on down the hill with a beautiful jump, but he choked a little bit in flight. Did not push it over the last part.
104 meters for Akimoto, and that is very disappointing for him. 341 feet. He finished fourth behind his teammate Yagi in the 70-meter jumps.
You see, he climbs a little too much in the beginning, and that pushes air the last part of the flight and drops him in early. They must make the proper curve.
And now we're only three jumpers away from the youngest jumper in the competition as these thousands look on what now is a slightly overcast day, a little blue sky overhead, but the temperature is just terrific. Skoda of Czechoslovakia, 106 meters, and that's quite a surprise. He finished 22nd on the 70-meter hill, but 106 meters is a fine jump today. All right, now we're looking at Peter Fijas of Poland. Fijas in practice went 108 meters. I think it surprised himself even.
These Polish boys are very good. They jumped very well in training.
Junior and seniors champion from Poland.
He has a tremendous amount of height, and he's curving it very well. It's another long jump.
That was Peter Fijas of Poland. Hey, 107 meters, Art Devlin. This boy is in form. Remember we said they have 12 seconds from the start to the landing. So everything has to be perfectly timed. They have to get that updraft lower on the hill. As we look at number 47 from Italy, the lone Italian jumper, Lido Tomasi.
And Tomasi, a little bit early, pulls it back and hangs in there for all he's worth.
Now, coming up will be the youngest jumper and tiniest, 15-year-old Steve Collins from Thunder Bay, Ontario. He's an Ojibwe Indian who's traveled around the world trying to perfect his ski jumping skills. Look at him, penciled thin. Where are the goggles? No goggles.
He'd better get out of there in a hurry because he's got a beautiful updraft right now. She's rising up the landing hill. You can see it out there.
5 feet to 104 pounds, and he's on the end run. 15 years old. Here he comes.
And little Stevie, here he goes down the hill. There's a long one. Hey, he did it.
Collins.
That a boy.
You know, only one medal ever. North American jumpers. Andras Hagen in the first Winter Olympic Games. Awarded to him 50 years after the fact. And Stevie Collins is fourth. Youngest of 15 years of age, and Art, he really put in a beautiful performance.
There he comes.
12 and a half.
Now you see Stevie get into what we call his delta wing. It's kind of a slow plow in the air. Now Carl Martis, the designer of this hill, tells me that he just lays on that little bit of flat surface there and just floats it all down the landing.
And now one of the great Austrians, Armin Kogler. Another beautiful jump. Armin Kogler. 110 meters. So Stevie Collins of Canada has outjumped one of the top Austrians by 2.5 meters. And Stevie Collins now is in fourth position with a round to go. An opportunity for a medal. This is Bogdan Norsic of Yugoslavia. He is number 50, last in this first round of jumps.
And Norsic just takes kind of a draw ride, not much of a jump.
Somewhere around 87 meters for Norsic of Yugoslavia. So it's Hans-Jörg Sumi of Switzerland with 117 meters in the first round. Our live coverage from Intervale here in Lake Placid. Prominent of Finland, 114.5. Neuper, 113. Stevie Collins of Canada, 112.5. Kukkonen of Finland, 110.5. Inar of Austria, 110. And America's Jim Denny. There is little Steve Collins, number 48. And he was so proud. The Ojibwe chief from Thunder Bay came down, Chief Hammond, along with his father and his uncle. Money provided by folks on the reservation and also in the town. So as we look at the two hills in one of the finest ski complexes in the world, repeating again that Hans-Jörg Sumi is in the lead, having jumped 117 meters, 384 feet. More from Lake Placid, but first, this pause. All right, we're back again at Intervale. The first round of jumps, 50 jumpers, 17 nations, and a little bit of a surprise, other than the leader, Art Devlin, Hans-Jörg Sumi of Switzerland, who's had the best length on practice jumps here, comes out after jumping only once when he had an opportunity to do four yesterday, and hits one for 117 meters and takes the lead.
There's no question about him taking the lead, and he really smacked that takeoff just as hard as you can possibly hit it. If you notice, when he went over the knoll, he's a little bit rough. Then he got on that updraft, that layer of air, and he just glided all the way down in that landing.
And Tormann in his second, Neuper of Austria third, and 15 years old, Steve Collins of Canada is in fourth position. Let's go back and look at Sumi's jump that covered 117 meters. loves the disco. He's an apprentice plumber. But boy, can he jump on your 90-meter hill, Art.
That disco dancing kept him.